in Action. I'm Jim Horton. We're talking with Melissa Kopecky, who is the library director of the South Orange Public Library. And we are going through some of the good points and bad points of things that are happening to libraries today. And it seems like a lot is coming down on library systems these days, good and bad news. Why don't you start with either one and take us through it?
Well, actually, I want to say I'm delighted to be here talking about my very favorite topic in the world, which is, of course, libraries. And actually, I'm somebody who always used libraries, always appreciated libraries, which is interesting because good news for libraries, as we're talking good and bad. A study was done last year in the state, funded in part by Verizon, and the literacy thing, which I thought was an excellent use of the money, was to survey the public about libraries and how they feel about libraries. And it really is true. People use the libraries a lot. Mm-hmm. And this study was not even now where the usage is up so much. They also appreciate libraries. Even people who are at a point in their life where they're not using the libraries constantly like the idea of libraries. They want them to be there, and they know it. At another point in their life, they'll probably be using them again. So I was one of those people until I sort of stumbled into a career in libraries and have gotten to appreciate even more so all of the things that public libraries in particular can be. So, yes, good news and bad news. I think you can't open any kind of publication these days without stumbling across some kind of library story. I mean, the New York Times, NPR, the Boston Globe. There was just one that came out this today, I believe, in Newsweek, all about the increased demand, the increased usage of public libraries, which is both a good and a bad thing. The good part, of course, is that people know that libraries are there and are using them, and they can, you know, when the economy first took a bit of a downturn and the things you kept finding in magazines and newspapers and online were the 10 lists, you know, 10 best ways to save money when things just looked, you know, a little bit bad. And you know, eating at home instead of going out to eat. I never found one of those listed that didn't have a library use on it somewhere, whether it was save money by checking out books at your local library, you know, save money by checking out movies at your local library, save money by, you know, going to free programming at your local public library. So right there is a reason to increase library usage. But in an economy where layoffs are a little more common and where people are worried about their jobs, the use of the library as a job center has become increasingly important. And the Newsweek article was about a librarian who in Michigan who was talking about how many people they use daily. Most jobs now, you have to have an email account to apply for the job, to send a resume by email. Mm-hmm. So first of all, you have to know how to use a computer. You have to know how to convert what may have been a paper document into an electronic document. You need to know how to set up an email account. And, you know, for those of us who do this all the time and have done it for years, that doesn't sound a lot. But just to see someone get the concept of what an email account is, and then it becomes a whole nother thing to come to check your email. You know, you did the one thing, you sent it out, but that's a whole nother process. And so there's several layers of helping people get comfortable with it. And this librarian in the article was talking about, which certainly I have seen, I mean, what if somebody's never used a mouse? You know, a computer mouse? That's a whole learning process. So, you know, how you look for the jobs that would be available online. I mean, 3 years ago, maybe, the state government stopped printing booklets, which they used to do. The libraries were a distribution point where you could go in and get your monthly listing of any state jobs available. They stopped that 3 years ago. It's all online. So right there, we already did, saw a big upsurge in public libraries about people job searching through libraries because just think 3 years ago, that was a much smaller percentage of the population who had their own computers or who had even now there's people who don't have high-speed internet. Again, those of us who are used to it don't stop and think about that, but your job search or any kind of browsing online is really slowed down if you're still using dial-up. Libraries have also found that's something people can let go, is their internet, monthly internet bill. And so you may have a computer at home, but then you may have your resume on a flash drive or a floppy drive and need to then, get online and upload it and email it in somewhere. So the job thing is big. And even if it's not actually looking for a job, anybody I think who's looking, who's back in the job market is looking to refresh their skills. So if it's just, a chance to go online and practice or to take a computer class or something like that. So that's certainly a key area that libraries across the United States have been seeing a huge upsurge.
And with all that, of course, budgets are being cut in libraries all across the United States. So there's greater demand but fewer dollars. Is that a correct statement?
Oh, that is most certainly a correct statement. And, it's agonizing, I'm sure, to anybody in a library to have to make cuts in services. But, cuts in your budget means at some point in the line, cuts in services. If you don't have as many librarians available, you're not going to be offering as many classes or you might be open less hours. And I think even in a time when people were using the library, but maybe not with such a sense of the need to use the library, that would have been painful. But it's hard times. I mean, everybody everywhere is faced with hard choices, but this is a hard choice because the choices can impact so many people. I mean, New York Public, they've made cuts to service hours, and they're some of the most intensely used public libraries in the country.
You're still working your budget out for the year for the South Orange libraries as of the time of this program. Do you see the possibility that you could be facing cuts yourself?
Well, I think like any public library director, well, of course we're facing, a reduced budget. I think everybody, whether in their personal life or their professional life, is facing a reduced budget. And in some ways that's good, and that's fiscally responsible, certainly when you're talking about municipal money. So it's that balance, though, between, how can you do this without greatly impacting the services, without really handicapping the people who need to use the library. So I feel like, everything is that. Librarians, people make fun of librarians sometimes because they believe so strongly in being organized and being efficient. And if you have an organization that's run that way, then it becomes extra hard, It's already organized. You can't save money by being more organized. Obviously nobody's perfectly organized. Anybody who saw my office would question whether I'm perfectly organized. But libraries as entities are really efficient ways of delivering services. And one of the things that I just love about public libraries, and I love about seeing libraries in different states and different places and different communities, is because public libraries really have this ability to be flexible in a way that that what we think of as, you know, long-standing institutions or things funded with government monies or maybe less flexible. But libraries, just by definition of all the things they do, and a public library by definition of being sort of a community center, are in a really good position to sort of be chameleons and do different things in different communities. So in a way, libraries were natural to pick up those people who needed. I mean, not only does it fit with the services that we have available, but libraries are also more flexible about being able to add services or enhance this or see that this is working and this is needed. And, you know, from a community that doesn't have art galleries or something, and you see the local library hosting art shows as a really essential part of the community, because, you know, they're the strongest player in that field. And to other places where there are lots of arts around and the library complements them, but it doesn't need to fill that particular service area. So, which is definitely, for me, one of the most addictive. It makes us able to be a little bit flexible then when we're looking at reduced budgets. But unfortunately, you know, I mean, something's reduced, something has to give. So, you know, it's just heartbreaking.
Do you see things like summer reading programs imperiled at this point, or... It would seem that the reference section of a library, where the job hunting and that occurs, is an area where you would almost want to protect and preserve your budget at this point. But then the question becomes, what about juvenile reading programs, for example? Can you protect those? What do you see as the give points, as the areas where you would have to say, I'm not so sure I can keep this area going?
I think that checking your library against the community is important. So, you know, looking for, well, maybe, you know, someone else will pick up the slack on that would be one thing. But I think also defining your really key services, and certainly childhood literacy is a key service to any public library.
So that's protected very carefully.
Yeah. Absolutely, positively. If one of the really neat things about libraries, too, is we're really one of the few institutions that serves really everybody, like all ages.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all ages. It's educational, cultural, all the different sort of flavors of what the library provides are still applied just across the board, from birth to, you know, to a senior citizen as you could get. And, you know, every economic background, every ethnic or any other kind of cultural background, really open to serving all those populations. So I think you also have to check it against, you know, what populations are being served elsewhere too, and where is there no service? So it's not just the job thing, you know, what else serves that pre-preschool or pre-kindergarten or pre-elementary age of child, and we're certainly very committed to that.
So we know then that certainly within the South Orange Public Library system, the childhood literacy is a very much protected program. Do you see things like library hours that might be jeopardized because of budget problems? I mean, is it, you keep all programs, you just reduce the number of hours. Is that a realistic, or is that just an area where cuts are a real problem?
I think probably most libraries, even just to take it more general than South Orange in specific or Maplewood, I think all are going to have to look at the possibility of reducing some hours. I think it would be looking at them in the places where they would impact, you know, the least number of people or have the greatest savings, you know, so you could devote that to more places. So that's certainly a possibility.
I'll tell you what, we have to take a break, and when we come back from the break, we'll look at the rest of it and where libraries are. And then I'd like to turn the conversation at that point to the new things that are coming down to libraries. We'll be back.
After 17 years working as a Mason, Mike was laid off. I met him when he came into the library looking for help. He found a job opening, but the application was only online. Mike said he'd spent his entire life around tools, but had never used a computer. I showed him how, and he ended up applying for numerous jobs online. I saw Mike the other day. His new computer skills paid off. He's working again.
New Jersey libraries are transforming lives. Tell us your story.
We're back. I'm Jim Horton. This is Books in Action, and we're talking with Melissa Kopecky, who is the director of the South Orange Public Library. And we were talking about areas of potential cuts in libraries and what needs to be protected. And I think you mentioned that hours will probably have to be cut in most libraries.
I think that's an obvious thing to look at. But to look at the, we said, the good and the bad, to get back to the good side of things and to see, libraries have been looking more carefully at what they do because of that, because you're making hard choices and this and that. But statewide in New Jersey, we participated in South Orange, and actually I believe Maplewood did too, but I don't know the results, in what they call the snapshot day, which is just to ask any library who could to just count things that day. Mm-hmm. So we'd really see a slice of life in libraries across New Jersey, and it was actually some school libraries and academic libraries participated as well as public. But it was absolutely amazing. We hand counted the people who came in the door, so I know it was very accurate. We didn't count. We took turns, which was a lot of fun because you get to talk to people as they come in. But we hand counted, so if somebody forgot their books in the car and ran back, you know, they didn't get double counted. So this was as accurate as you could get. No staff people were counted. And in that day, and it was a day that we were open from 9 in the morning till 9 o'clock at night, we had 522 people come into the library that day.
That's and significant.
I think all of us were just walking around at the end of the day going, wow, that's absolutely amazing. I mean, and amazing in a really exciting way. Now, we did have some programs that day, but they were well attended. We had a children's program, a family program, a senior program, and in the evening we had our an annual program that we run around the Academy Awards. So all of those were nicely attended, and that was just under 200 people came to all those programs, which still leaves over 320 people who came into the library to do other things. And you know, we're not a humongous library system, and that was just absolutely wonderful. I always tell people that I'm the luckiest library director in the world because I have such a great staff to work with. And I think that, you know, just to see everybody so excited when we were looking at these numbers. I mean, we had circulation that day. We had, another thing, we had a computer class that day. But, you know, we counted tax forms that we gave out, which, you know, libraries are also the main place to get tax forms. And a lot of the specialty forms, they don't print at all anymore, so people who don't have a computer need the, you know, mm-hmm. the library to print out the form, find and print out the forms they need. So any one of a number of reasons that people were coming in, and we, you know, we checked out a lot of things that day, but there were a lot of people coming in for a lot of other reasons, and I think that's really inspiring, and that's the nice part about being in a library. Yes, you're facing hard choices, and you're looking at, you know, trying to balance cutting a budget without, you know, devastating services, but it's also just a wonderful place to be. I mean, you're at a real place where real things are happening, and such a variety of things, it's absolutely never boring.
You know, that's interesting because it was sort of thought that when the internet came along and when now, of course, software books like Kindle, Amazon's Kindle, and downloadable YouTube and downloadable music and downloadable books that, and Wikipedia, of course, we can't forget Wikipedia, that the library was, if to use a term, superannuated, that it was an essential information resource that was slowly receding as people moved everything onto their machines. But it seems to be exactly the opposite.
Well, I would agree with you, and I think people are slowly understanding that. I think for a long time, every place I went, people find out you're a librarian, and they're like, okay, why do we need you? We have Google. And that was it, but I really don't hear that so much anymore. And I think it's an acknowledgement of two things. I think one is that, you know, okay, so you could get 5,000 results with Google. Who's going to help you figure out which ones are the good ones? And, you know, people are starting to be awash in too much information. And the flip side of it is that the physical space becomes that much more important. I mean, if you think about it, where can you find non-commercial public spaces that are just open to any, you know, to all sorts of purposes and any kind of ideas, and just an amazing concept that is. So it's the best of both worlds as far as I'm concerned right now, because we have the physical space, which has always been there. We have the physical books, and the need for that kind of physical thing isn't going to disappear if you start thinking about archives and needing to preserve things, which is another whole piece of libraries that sounds like it's kind of boring to think about, but it's really pretty essential to any civilization to want to preserve their knowledge.
And librarians pioneered information classification.
Yes, indeed.
I mean, all the way back to the libraries of Alexandria and in the Roman times. They had some rather interesting classifications they used, but they certainly did that.
Yes, they did. And because of people thinking that that's important, well, that's why we know about past civilizations. So there's that, but there's also then the excitement of what you can do now that you couldn't do 20 years ago or 50 years ago, and how you can disseminate that information so much more easily. And for us, how some library services we can offer around the clock. So it's not, you're not no longer tied to the physical space, even as the physical space becomes even more important. Mm-hmm. So that's just a really exciting time, and you referred to ebooks, and there would be an example of any kind of electronic material that people would be wanting to check out, could be checked out without actually physically coming into the library, which is a really great thing. excuse me, we don't actually have ebooks at the moment, which is really interesting because we are part of a consortium that purchases downloadable audiobooks. Mm-hmm. And I've been pitching that we need to get ebooks as well for the past 2 years. And just now other libraries are saying, yeah, let's start looking into the ebooks.
So how would that work? If you have, there are like 270,000 books now that are ebooks. Or more. I think Amazon has 270,000 just itself, not counting everyone else. So how would you do that? Would you buy a selection of books that would then be downloadable for a period of time, or have you figured out the system yet? Because that's really taking libraries in a whole new direction, isn't it?
Well, yes, and it's all about content, which is what a lot of the electronic conversations about information, mm-hmm. and certainly copyrighted material, it's all about the content and who has access to it. I am so sorry. So we work with a company, actually, that negotiates with the publishers for the rights.
I see.
To these books, because publishers are treating electronic copies of books differently than they do the hard copy. Like, nobody has a problem with a hard copy of a book or of a music CD being in a library to circulate to people. But when it becomes an electronic copy, the whole set of rules is different.
That's, yeah, and I have a feeling that given the amount of digital rights arguments that are underway these days, that it's going to be some time yet before there is a standard agreement as to how to do this. But I know going in and out of Manhattan where I work, I see more and more people standing on the subway or on the train reading now e-books. Most of them seem to be using the Amazon Kindle, but they are straightforward e-books. And I've stopped several people and asked them what they felt like reading these, and they said it's just terrific, you know, that it's they just throw it in their briefcase and go on with it, and it's no more of the 600, 800 pages sticking out.
Well, sure, if you think in the size and weight of a paperback that you can be carrying 100 books at a time, you know, you're not going to run out of things to read. I actually have a Sony ebook reader, and there is another one, excuse me, just hitting the market that actually has a color screen, which will be a whole new thing now. It's way more expensive than anything already on the market. So that technology is going to change really fast, and it'll change and win over a lot of people who are not used to reading that way.
And it'll impact you almost immediately.
Certainly. I mean, I don't think it will ever replace the need for paper, or certainly not anytime soon. And paper as a form of archiving is going to be around. I don't think everybody's going to want to read electronically, or even people who love it are not necessarily going to want to read that way all the time. So, but it certainly expands our options.
Okay, well, we've run out of time.
I
want to thank you very much.
As I'm running out of my voice, sorry about that.
We've been talking with Melissa Kopecky, who is the director of the South Orange Public Library, and this is Books in Action. I'm Jim Horton, and thank you very much for watching.